Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning, everyone. Everyone that's a member, everyone that's a visitor and a guest, we welcome you today. It's October 2nd. That means it's a little bit chillier, so I hope you got your sweaters with you when we leave here today. So welcome everyone to the Lord's house, this day of worship. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us now sing our introit, which is we lift our names on high. And if you remember some of the hand gestures, please feel welcome to sing along and move along. And we welcome our pastor, yay! And we're doing the introit. We've already done welcome and announcements. So we welcome you for joining us. We appreciate it and hope that you are well this morning. And you're all even here. You did a good job getting dressed. You did good. Okay, so now we're gonna have our introit.
Okay.
Still trying to catch my breath. Stayed a little too long up in Oakwake there, and but we had a good time, and it was a wonderful time. So here we are, beginning our worship, and I just pray God's presence here among us. We're going to have Holy Communion, little later in the service. So let us begin now with this call to worship. We are not possible without you, God.
We are the promise of those who came before.
We influence those who come after.
You bind generations to one another.
We offer the treasures we find in you to one another.
As we bow down through the ages.
Hear us as we worship you. Our opening hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness, number 140. Join me now in this opening prayer. Gracious God, We come before you as bearers of a faith for which we are not always known. Sometimes we shrink from the gift entrusted to us, as if it is the least part of ourselves, as if passing trivialities matter more, as if faith has no real weight in the scheme of things. Forgive us for our turning from your gifts. Call us back to life in you, today and every day. Amen. This first scripture from today, just wanted to give you a little background. And the saga continues on. If you recall, Jeremiah, one prophet out of 400 who was a prophet of calamity and destruction. Babylon had defeated and taken away the whole administration of Judah, including the temple priests and their treasury, everything. And it was desolation. We're going to hear that now from Lamentations.
How lonely sits the city that was once full of people. How like a widow she has become. She that was great among nations, she that was a princess among the provinces, has become subject to forced labor. She weeps bitterly in the night with tears on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she has no one to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone into exile with suffering and hard servitude. She lives now among the nations. She finds no resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her in the midst of her distress. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate. Her priests groan, her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters. Her enemies prosper because the Lord has made her suffer for the multitude of her transgressions. Her children have gone away, captives before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princes have become like stags that find no pasture. They fled without strength before the pursuer. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord.
Epistle lesson this morning is from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is written through you, the laying up of my hand. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed then of the testimony about our Lord or of me his prisoner, but join me in suffering for the gospel in the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. And this grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do, but I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard the deposit I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us.
May God's blessing be added to this, his word. Our next hymn is Open My Eyes That I May See, number 454.
Chapter 17, verses 5 through 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink. Later, you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. The words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Be seated. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and loving God, we've been singing our songs, our hymns, and listening to words of Scripture. And now we ask for your help that you may help us to open our eyes and our ears, that we may proclaim the way, the truth, and the life of Jesus. So we ask you now to help us. I ask you now to help me as I speak. May my thoughts, my words, be worthy of your life-giving word. Amen. I couldn't get over this passage. We have another one that's very difficult to extract the meaning here. The apostles sounds almost demanding, increase our faith. Somehow they felt the need to have more. And then Jesus gives them this illustration about a slave who comes in from plowing and tending sheep. Come here at once and take your place at the table. Would you rather not say to him, prepare supper for me, put on your apron, serve me while I eat and drink, and later you may drink? So what's Jesus getting at here? And then the finishing line, we are worthless slaves, you know, and sometimes I feel that way myself. Not as a slave, but just as a person. So this is all about faith. And Jesus says, you know, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could make incredible things happen, like this plant. Got me to thinking about Bolivia. This morning I was reminded, Pastor Evie went to Bolivia with me on one of those tours, and she would know exactly what I'm talking about. But it all started with Jane Middleton, our now retired Bishop Middleton. And as she was newly a district superintendent, part of the training was to go to Bolivia with Nora and Wilson Boots, longtime missionaries. And they had a project going on there, and it concerned Chagas disease. This disease was ravaging the villages on the mountains. And it took quite a while for them to figure out where it was coming from. And as it turns out, it came from a little critter about an inch long who was a blood-sucking critter. In the middle of the night, these are nocturnal insects, they would seek to drop down on a person and take blood. But what they left behind was a disease. I don't remember if it was bacteria or some kind of parasite. But once an adult came down with this disease, they weren't likely to live beyond 45 years. So there was a sense of urgency now that they found out where it came from. They discovered that if they put a concrete slab down and build the traditional structure out of sod, and then they put stucco on the walls inside and out, really smooth. They replaced the thatch roof because that's where these insects lived. And we put up galvanized sheet metal roofs. All in all, the whole project to build a two-room home cost $750. That's the miracle of this mission. And there was a local cement factory that donated all the cement they needed to pour the floors. And the owner, or the village people, would contribute their portion of $350. And what we would offer is $500. And she came back very excited of the possibilities of eradicating this disease. And, you know, I went down on several trips. Pastor Evelyn, you remember her?
Yes.
Yeah, she went up there in the mountains too. And we had jeeps and a bus and stuff like that. But my wife Diane got this bright idea. She crafted a little house that looked exactly like the ones in Bolivia on the mountaintop. And we would sell them at conference for $500 a piece. And we sold a bunch of them. Because the promise of building a home for $500 on our side, wow, you spend that much for your dishwasher, you know, or a refrigerator, you know, and what a bargain. And of course, the people, they built their own homes. We didn't really build any, but we made possible, and we visited them, and I think they, after we left, they had hope, they had faith, and Bishop Park was with us on one trip. Who remembers the bishop? He says,
Jeremiah
Park, yeah, right, and one time at conference, he said, hallelujah. And then he said, do you know how to say that in Korean? We waited a few seconds and he goes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So he was with us on one trip. He was... altitude sickness set in for a couple of days. This is before we went into the mountains. And though here we were up at 11,000 feet, They had built one home as a model. People were living in it, but that's what they wanted. And there were about 60 families in this community. And we took it upon ourselves to make it happen by selling all these little houses. And there were other mission volunteers in mission who helped with this project as well. And so here's Bishop Park. And he was a rather physical prayer. He would grab the hands of everybody in the circle. We had this conversation, and it had to be translated from the people who spoke Quechua, had to be translated to Spanish, and then finally to English. So it took a while for us to exchange our ideas and our wishes. So he would grab people's hands like this, and he started praying, and he's going like this. And right in the middle of his prayer, we heard this cry, and I looked over, and I saw a mother goat delivering a baby. Right then, right at the same moment. And I don't know how many people saw that, but it hit me right here. You know, it was just a wonderful sign of new life coming into the world. On another trip, we visited a community that had finished building their homes, including piping water down from the mountain into the village, nice, clean, cold water. And they were dedicating this last home, and I was to cut the ribbon. And the reason they handed the scissors to me is that last home built was for the pastor of the community. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first, right? It was so sweet. So, yeah, I'm thinking of faith and Timothy, who Paul kind of took him under his wings and encouraged him in the faith. But he reminded Timothy that to remember his grandfather, mother Lois, and his mother Eunice, and how they had passed on the faith to him. That isn't always how it happens. But for Timothy, that's what it was. And then, of course, when he was under the care of Paul, he grew and grew and became a very effective evangelist. So it got me to thinking about where I got my faith. And I thought of my grandmother. The last time I saw her, I was 5 or 6 years old in Sweden. She had a little farm out there, and she had chickens, and I don't know, I can't remember the other animals. But she was a Baptist, and she did Bible studies in her home on, I believe, Wednesday evenings. My dad, of course, growing up in the household, I don't know how much of this is mythology or what, but it was told that he would preach to the sheep from a stump of an old tree, you know. And I was trying to picture that, but my dad was kind of an evangelist. And but I got to thinking about my mother, Amy. And she wasn't very loud or persuasive with sharing her faith. But one time, of course, she stayed home on Sundays to cook dinner for us. She would have been better off going to church and forget the dinner. But anyway, we sat down once. This is after I was in the Navy, and I had come to appreciate my mother so much more when I was away from home. I remember calling her, and that's when you had to put money in the phone, 3 minutes, and it would tell you you're running out of time or something, and I would grab it in my pocket and keep putting money in. But one time I was home with her, and she told me about an experience she had in Sweden. She was born in the U.S., married my dad from Sweden, and during the Depression, they went back to Sweden where there was an opportunity for my father. And as I remember, she wasn't that well received. You know, can you imagine someone who speaks broken Swedish with a Brooklyn accent? I don't know if people made fun of her or what, but she was longing for home. And her sisters-in-law were Pentecostal. And they brought my mom to probably more than one Pentecostal meeting. And she was very troubled, and she asked in her heart for Jesus to give her a sign that he is for sure the real thing. And she told me she saw Jesus at the front of the sanctuary. And probably no one else saw that. That was for her. It was a gift from God to give her that blessed assurance. And I tell you, that was part of me building my own faith. But then there was Pastor Barry. We went to a Swedish Lutheran church, and I was about 13 years old, and there were about six of us kids getting ready for confirmation class. And Pastor Barry was an ex-Marine, and he was tough. He was like a tough coach, but a wonderful, loving man. But he terrified us. Every Saturday morning, we'd have to come to our class and recite passages from Luther's Small Catechism. And we all did. But he left a mark on me that would last to this day, you know. He was just an amazing man. So here we are now. From that Lamentations passage, for several weeks now, I've been talking about the destruction of Judah, the tearing down of the temple. They had lost everything. And they wondered, where was God? And there's a Psalm 137, I believe, that speaks about the Babylonians who had these now slaves at their disposal. And they would ask the people from Judah, the defeated people, to sing the songs of Zion, beautiful songs. Play your harps and sing the song. And as the psalm goes, how can we sing the songs of Zion where we are now? Our tongue would stick to the roof of our mouth. How can we sing? The one thing, through it all, at the end, it talks about, again, reconstruction. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Think of all the people in the world. The destruction down in Florida, unimaginable. The war in Ukraine. And other parts of the world where people are running out of water and places where there's too much water. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Faith comes in, especially when we believe we have nothing else, when life has become impossible. But to have faith means you have something to stand on. When everything seems to be falling apart, we can stand on the faith that God has given us. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. How do we, as servants of God, share the faith that we have? Some wise person said, it's your actions that people remember. And if not your actions, you can use words. But it's how we lead our lives every day. And our actions conveying the hope that faith allows, the hope of the resurrection. As I've said before, being kind to the person that's serving you at the cash register or at the gas station or the bank, a smile speaks louder than anything you can tell them. Have a good day. And just a little bit of cheer can make an immense difference in a person's life. So, my family, think about these things. What else do you have but faith? Amen. Oh, Father, Father of your Son, Jesus, hear the cry of the people, we ask, of the devastation in Florida and various counties and communities, giving thanks for all who respond, especially those who are saving life. Lord, may this be a time of people who oppose one another on policy and politics will now turn to their neighbor with love and open arms and open purses, that we may focus as a nation on the troubled spots of our land, for the people of Puerto Rico who were just barely getting over the last hurricane. So we ask for help for those who've lost their homes, for those few that have lost loved ones. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Skip, who's coming home to die. Lord, wrap your arms around him and Janice. Give to them the faith that they need. And may those who love and cherish draw up close and give them the comfort of presence and an open mind and an open heart. We celebrate the coming of a new grandson. We think of our grandchildren and great-grandchildren. We think about families who struggle in these economic woes, putting food on the table and fuel in the car and heat for the homes. May siblings and parents love one another. Lord, we think of all the people who serve. Sometimes they work like they were slaves, and yet there are places around the world where people are slaves. So we look to you as the one who can create possibility where there is no possibility. So we call upon you to encourage and empower leaders of countries, of nations, for you love them all. We ask that you bless their work, that you open up resources to bring about health, to bring about hope for the coming days. Oh God, as we prepare to go back into the world, we pray that we might bring with us your presence. Your presence, whether it just be silent or words of comfort. All these things now we leave with you, trusting and praying in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord be with you. I need one minute.
Peace of the Lord.
I ask it now. Turn to page 8 in the hymnal. Christ our Lord invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, and so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it." And so he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many
for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing of the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing of the blood of Christ. Come now, all is prepared that you may receive the gifts of God for the people of God. Our closing hymn is Help Us Accept Each Other, number 560.
Ancient and new.
We go forth with the infinite faith of our Lord.
May your path shine with the light and love.
Amen.
Let us go now from this house of worship into the world, sharing the love of God wherever you go. Go now in the precious name of Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.